Right. So, going to give a short introduction to 64 Studio, what it's about, and then get on with the actual demo. So, I'll just like to point out the linuxaudio.org. I don't know if any of you have been to that site. That's a sort of consortium of projects and companies working on audio related things. We actually do graphic software and publishing software and things like that in 64 Studio, but the main emphasis so far seems to have been on the audio side. Right, so 64 Studio is a custom Debian distribution. It's a one disk install. The 1.0 version, which came out in the autumn of last year, was a single CD-ROM. The 2.0 version, which will be out later this summer, is a DVD instrument. But it's just a one disk. You stick it in, you know, reboot, and it precedes most of the install questions you can normally get with Debian, which is, you know, part of our aim of making it easier for non-technical users. Because a lot of people who want to use their computers in a creative way are not particularly technical. They know the applications that they use every day inside out, but IT in general, you know, is often not their area. So we took the decision to design it for stability rather than to be, you know, on the bleeding edge the whole time. So a number of the packages will be the very latest, necessarily, but they will have at least gone through some quality assurance testing over at least a sort of a month or so to make sure we don't put out a numbered release that's got lots of, you know, showstopper bugs, crashing bugs, that kind of thing. Our ultimate aim is to sort of go beyond stability to achieve reliability. In other words, the machine not only doesn't crash, but you can rely on it to do its job every day. You know, when you hit record, you expect the audio to actually be on the disk. That's not always the case with computers, of course. So once you go beyond just crashing bugs and achieve that sort of level of reliability. So basically, we're looking at to make a crazy desktop that is as good as a Debian server is in its role. You know, you can leave it running for a couple of years, you can come back and it'll still be running, and you know, you don't have to deal with machines slowing down or getting sort of corrupted in the way that Windows machines tend to do inexplicably over you know, long periods of time. Because a lot of these creative users that we're targeting, they don't want to be uploading new packages every day, but or downloading new packages every day, upgrading every few months. You know, they want to install a machine and, or have it install form and probably never touch the software side of things until they get a new machine. So we try and automate everything as much as possible. The final point on this slide is the distro is absolutely free as in beer. The nearest equivalent to 64 Studio in the proprietary world is probably Adobe's Creative Suite, which is, you know, graphics, publishing, audio, video tools. And that runs into, I think it's a couple of £1,000 for the full version, you know, with everything in it per seat. And obviously that makes it very difficult to afford for a lot of people in the creative industries are freelancers. They don't have a lot of money when they're starting out. There's a lot of students and people who have the technology and the will to use their computers creatively, but the high cost of proprietary applications is a barrier to entry. And it's fair to say that hardware has come down in price a great deal in the last sort of 10, 15 years, but the proprietary applications in the creative sphere haven't followed suit. They're still just as expensive as they were back in the sort of 80s and 90s. You know, even like a desktop publishing application can be, you know, £900 per seat, something like that. And so students and freelancers, people like that, don't get access to all the tools they can actually use. Particularly in education, what that means is get colleges and schools spending a great deal of money on proprietary software, investing in it effectively, but they still are still not able to put that full set of creative tools in front of a student or a pupil, which is unfortunate. If you get a default install of Windows XP, something like that, it doesn't have a great deal of creative tools on board. The ones it has are pretty poor. So we think we've got something to offer there. So what is 64 Studio is not fork day. It's actually freshly built on a continuous basis from Debian sources. We actually fix bugs in Debian itself rather than maintain a separate tree. So our lead developer, Priya Kanaka, is a DB, and he actually he's on the multimedia team, and he's like fixing bugs in Debian packages every day. And then what we do is when we want to make a release, we take a snapshot, or in the case of our forthcoming 2.0 release, it will be edge-based, as our development releases are at the moment. And so we're fixing bugs directly in Debian, and rather than creating something separate from Debian. We don't strip out Debian logos or trademarks or any of that kind of stuff. When you put the CD in, it says, welcome to Debian, and hit F1, or enter to install world. Whereas there are a lot of derivative distributions that strip out the D word, the swirly logo, from the whole thing to give the impression that they're creating something other than Debian or superior to Debian or what we have their own trademarks. We don't do any of that. So another point: it's not just a platform for non-free apps, because I was giving a talk in Los Angeles where there are approximately 5,000 artists using GNU/Linux on a daily basis in that city, working mostly for the movie studios and the TV production, that kind of thing. But the vast majority of them are using almost exclusively proprietary applications on the Linux space. So they've got maybe Red Hat Enterprise or whatever, and then they've got Maya or Nuke or one of those kind of applications, which is some of them are proprietary from small specialist proprietary software houses. Others are in-house apps that have been developed by some of the movie studios through the rules here about using Linux. And they never actually get released to the public at all, proprietary or free software. So when we decided to create this distro like 2 years ago, it was important to us to have a full roster of free software applications running on a free software platform. So it's not just a sort of a free software lead-in to to people forking out these proprietary apps. So thirdly, it's not just about music software. That seems to have been the main emphasis so far. I think that's partly because the stock distros don't have a great deal of music software on there, and they don't usually have things like a real-time kernel and Jack Audio Server and so on. So if you're looking to make music with free software, there's more reason to use a specialist distro for music and audio. Like, for example, if you're doing graphics, then you can get packages for Inkscape, DMC Paint, and Blender, and things like that from most mainstream distros without having to do too much system tweaking. And fourthly, as we were saying, the creative user base is not necessarily very IT literate, and probably never used Linux before, or may have used it on a web server or something, but never actually used it at the desktop. So we're trying to make it as easy as possible. We're going to use a friendliness every time, basically. So you plug in a digital camera, and through Dbus, you get Gthumb launched to import your photos. And it's all aimed at that sort of ease of use in mind. I've actually tried a few OS X or OS X systems and found famed ease of use. I actually found them quite confusing and difficult to get to grips with. I used to use a Mac like 10 years ago, and the way that OS X does its menus and applications and launching where to find your files. I didn't actually find that intuitive at all. And so I think there's still some work to be done there to actually achieve a sort of you know, gold standard of usability. I don't think Apple actually has it all to themselves. One of the things we do, for example, is we changed the GNOME default configuration around a little bit. So that instead of having the menu at the top, we put it at the bottom. Now, the top menu is obviously the GNOME default, is what Ubuntu uses. It's Etch as well, so this, as far as I can recall. But you know, we actually looked at what people were used to, and you know, maybe 95% of the user base is used to having the start menu in the bottom left-hand corner, and just a click on the icon, up comes a dead straightforward list of applications, and you find the one you want in the category, and click on it. Yeah. And that's how most people, having come up through Windows 95, 98, XP, expect computers to work. So that's how we did it. So who are we? Free Epinarka is the technical leader of the project. He's originally from Italy, but he's actually living in Berlin at the moment. Tim Hall is sort of the documentation guy. He's a musician. Sort of background, he's come into free software through the Mudi project, and so he writes the sort of user manuals and things like that. Because I'm sort of a project founder, company director, I get to do the dumb user testing. So I click on things, oh, that doesn't work, well, I make a note, put a ticket on the website. So we've generated like 300 and something tickets, I think, since we started. We've churned through quite a few of those. We've got fixes for most of them. I also get to do all the paperwork. So, yeah, I think I've got a long deal, actually. We have lots of people helping us in our user community, user developer community. Some people are just, I tried this and it wouldn't install the world. Other people are saying things like, oh, well, I found this problem, and here's a fix, which is great, because we're getting that active involvement. And a couple of the projects that we package with the distro. Actually, some of our users have gone on to become maintainers or co-maintainers of those packages which have gone unmaintained for whatever reason. To give an example, a slightly less obvious example, there's a package in GNOME for tracking time spent on projects called GNOME Time. And it's not shipped by default with a lot of distros. There's some slightly less obvious package, but that's sort of not completely unmaintained, but development had slowed down a bit. And one of our users said, because he lives in South Africa, and they have the Rand as a currency, he said, well, I'm a freelancer and I need to use GNOME Time to generate invoices. So he noticed that the invoice generating feature of GNOME Time, which is actually quite handy if you're a freelancer, has the dollar sign like hard coded. Invoice generating code. So he actually worked up a patch to change that to a user settable currency symbol. But that's only a small change, but it makes that program now extremely useful for for the kind of people that we're targeting, many of whom are freelancers and need to track their project time and generate their own invoices. Now that's, as I say, that's a less obvious example because it's not a multimedia application as such. But it's the kind of application that once you get into it, it's so useful you can't do without it, right? So you don't need like a full accounting system if you're one of our target users necessarily. You just need to be able to track your project time and actions and invoices and so on. So we're trying to think of the whole sort of gestalt, if I can use that word, of the creative milieu. That's one German word and one French word at the same time. So anyway, how are we funded? Well, we are a private company and not a not-for-profit or sort of a pure community project. We've got a custom work offering that we have, and we've using the sort of platform that we've developed and building on that for various projects. And later in this year, we're going to be doing end-user support as well. So because people are actually coming to us and saying, oh, I really want someone to be able to like answer my questions and so on. Because the community support is great, but my questions are so dumb, you know, that nobody could be bothered to answer them. Or my questions are, people with the strangest hardware combinations, you know, that nobody else has got. And they need somebody to spend like 3 days tracking it down for them, whatever. That's, you know, community support has so many advantages, but it doesn't suit all people in all situations. And there are other people, like institutional users, you know, like at colleges and large companies and things like that, where they feel better, you know, if they can have some, like, some paid support. And there are very few places where you can go at the moment for multimedia desktop support. You can get the support from Ubuntu and Fedora, well, you know, Red Hat or Enterprise and so on. But there aren't any sort of any small, large, medium companies that are providing support services for the kind of software that we're doing. So we're also thinking about seriously about having a hardware shop type website, because you go into like a PC World store or something and you say, you know, is this like supported by Debian Etch or whatever? I don't even know if it's supported by Windows Vista. It's a frustrating experience trying to actually buy things, you know, buy a laptop with Debian on it, or buy you know, a piece of hardware like this. And you know, you can go to M Audio, we make these little USB audio interfaces. And say like, oh, does that work with like Linux? And they go, oh yeah, it definitely works with Linux. There's some guy who did a driver somewhere, but you know, they can't tell you about like kernel versions, ALSA versions, or anything like that. They just know that there's Linux support for that product, maybe, if you use the right revision, you know, of the firmware and blah, blah, blah. So we're thinking about having a website where we have things like this, and you can just click on it and buy it, and you know that it definitely works for Debian, that we've personally tested it. I don't know if that's actually going to be useful to people or not, but I think I'll be really useful. So, the projects we've been doing. This is late in 2005, we started on this one. This is the Lion's Tracks Media Station. It's a very large workstation keyboard. It was the first instrument of its kind to be publicly launched as running new Linux. Actually before the Korg Oasis, which is the sort of Korg, one of the worldwide brand leaders in synths. And they now also have a Linux-based keyboard called the Oasis, that's O-A-S-Y-S. But this was actually the first. Originally, the prototype ran Red Hat Linux 9, I think. This was going back about 3 or 4 years. The company switched to a stock Debian install to get the benefits of apt and so on. But the problem with making a distro fit to an instrument like this, which is obviously not a standard PC, it has a PC motherboard inside it, and it has a PC CPU, and hard disk and so on, but actually you can see it's got a small touch screen in the center there instead of a full-size monitor, so you can plug it in. And obviously it's got a QWERTY keyboard, so it's not altogether like a PC. So most companies, and there's another one, this work of the Hartman Neuron, which is also Linux-based. Since there's quite a few of these big synths now, running actually a free software called. Now, the standard approach to this is to take a standard distro like Debian or Gentoo or whatever, and stick it on the machine, and then get all your special apps you need for running the keyboard or the touchscreen or whatever, package them up in a giant tarball, and then when it comes to installing the machine, stick on your distro, unpack your giant tarball, you know, and there's your the software, right? So run a couple of scripts and overwrite all the defaults. The problem with that is, what you've created essentially is a fork, because it's like a sort of a Debian or Gentoo version, whatever it is, frozen in time at that point. And then you've got a choice. You can update the underlying distro, in which case the stuff that's in the tarball is probably going to break, or you can leave the distro as it is and watch it get horrendously out of date. Because, as I say here, when you buy one of these large, expensive instruments, you expect it to last for a great deal longer than a PC's lifetime. So a PC's got 3-year lifespan, laptop maybe 2 years if it doesn't break in half. But if you buy one of these instruments, and they are quite expensive, you might expect it to last as long as your Hammond organ, or your synth you bought back in the 80s, so 10, 20, even 30 years is not uncommon. So the answer we came up with is to have a sort of a rolling platform that we keep maintaining for the distro, and actually keep it up to date, and package everything in DEBs, so that what you've got is a custom Debian distribution that's tailored for this specific device. It's not fork, but it's on the sort of it's part of the tree of our main distro, but with some special settings for this particular hardware because it was in a standard PC. And that seems to work quite well. You end up with something that's pretty up to date with current distros, whether it be Edge or whatever it's based on. And you can actually, because you've got a new build being generated all the time automatically, you can watch out for breakages and things like that as they happen. Because the alternative, as I say, is to, if you freeze that distro in time, nobody wants to backport stuff to a distro that's like 10 years old. It just wouldn't happen. So when we tailored Debian to fit better on this instrument. So that was more or less done now. We sort of completed that work late last year, and that's actually shipping now. This is what we're working on at the moment. It's about this is actually an 8-inch screen, so the whole device is sort of that size. It's maybe half the size of a laptop on average. It's the first portable digital audio workstation, for sure. That is, as far as we know, it was running through software. And it's also the first sort of portable device that's optimized for audio. So for example, you get a standard laptop, it has an eighth of an inch mini jack with a pretty poor audio chipset on it. Because that's one of the things that laptop manufacturers cut costs on. So you end up having to buy an external box like this to actually get proper microphone inputs and so on. So what this thing is, let's say, smaller and hopefully lighter, longer battery life than the laptop, and it actually has these kind of XLR sockets with fancy power for your sort of proper microphones. And the idea being that it's smaller overall and more compact. You don't have to have all these different wires that we've got going on here today to actually use it. The idea being that if you're sort of on a plane or something, you can actually work on your project. It's got no QWERTY keyboard, of course. It's got a thumb pad on the right hand side and two mouse buttons on the left. So you're actually holding it a bit like you would a small games console, like that. But you've got your headphone output right there, and on the back, which you can't see, there's the microphone inputs and the line outputs. And the idea behind this is that you'll work on a project, say on a plane or a bus, wherever you happen to be, and then you can, because it's got Ethernet on the back as well, and Wi-Fi, you can connect to the internet and upload your finished project to your studio server or your streaming website or whatever it is. So, this also runs another sort of branch of the distro that's optimized for this, and it's due for launch later this year.
One question about the update. Mm-hmm. If somebody buys this instrument, mm-hmm. and does he get every year a CD with the update, or is this done by a network?
Network.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, both for the media station and for the Trinity, they've both got Ethernet.
And the user have to activate it, or is it normal that if there's a new update available, the instrument will just download it and...
It's not pushed out to the unit at the moment. You actually have to run an app to get this upgrade at the moment on this one. What we'll probably do have in the final version is just an update the
update button. Yeah.
Yeah. We actually have a script called 64Studio-upgrade, which basically does all your app to get update, get this upgrade, and all that kind of stuff. And it also pulls in because we have scripts to reset configurations back to their default state before we screw them up. So it runs all back up. So
Yeah, it's basically like a pocket-sized studio with the power of Debian apt in it. Yeah. So that's enough talking. I'll do some showing. This is, here on the laptop, this is our 1.40 development release. That's actually a close-up of Steve Harris's guitar. Steve Harris is the author of Jammin' and a lot of DSP effects. The Lanspa sort of project. But yeah, there's an extreme close-up. So superficially, it looks pretty similar to the 1.0 release, which we have running on the machine in the by the window there in the middle, if you want to have a try on that later. But we've updated a lot of packages since then. I mean, the 1.0 release last September, we were running a 2.6.17 kernel, which is okay for most machines, unless they're very new, in which case it doesn't have support for the latest SATA chipsets and things like that. So, and we've made various bug fixes and tweaks and package updates since then. So this will be the basis of the 2.0 release, which will be later this summer. So, notable updates actually. We've got ARDA 2.0, which is GTK 2 based rather than GTK 1 based, came out not long ago, and we've got that in there. This is another new one. That's an organ emulator, but not like a sort of a home organ. It's a full-size church organ emulator. So you can actually assign like banks of MIDI keyboards and foot pedals and a whole lot. So you can do the whole, you know, Phantom of the Opera thing with that. It's you've got the only thing is you do need a lot of keyboards to work with. Kind of, you know, but that is a very very good project. It's all done in software. It's not sampled at all, because there are some Linux-based church organs. There's one in the World Trade Center in New York. They actually replaced the original church organ that was destroyed with the attack on the September 11th with a Linux-based sampling organ, which is like basically like a rack of 10 machines all running like these really big disk samples of, you know, real church organs. But this one is all completely on the CPU. You know, all it's all generated, you know, rather than sampled. And it sounds pretty good. So we've got little things that were in the previous release, like AMS, which is the modular synth running in the back there, and all the sort of the popular favorites like Audacity and so on. Some instrument tuners, instrument tuner, and freewheeling, which is like a looping sample kind of thing. And so what else we've got? The DSSI oscilloscope, which is another handy tool. And we've popped in Terminator X and a few other effects. We've also updated a new version of Inkscape and Screwless. In that place. So, yeah, general updates, but the biggest advantage of the 2.0 release, I think, over the 1.0 is the 2.0 is etch-based, whereas the 1.0 was based on snapshot testing from like last September. So in terms of actual package compatibility, you know, it's 2.0 will be better because you'll have much less chance of getting a broken package, and you'll also have security support for the first time. We're now based on after 2 years, we're now based on a stable release rather than a testing release. when we started, Sarge was already too old in terms of package numbers, package tuner versions to base on, so we went with a snapshot up to the edge release. We have got K3D as well now, which is a sort of blender-like program. That's a new one. But since we're talking about music today, I haven't started yet. Okay, we'll start with Jack. So, has anybody not used Jack? Okay, I'll give it a quick introduction to Jack. Most audio applications take the approach of grabbing the sound card or the audio interface for its exclusive use. And a lot of music applications on proprietary platforms work the same way. They grab the interface and don't let any other application use it. Now the problem with that is if you're taking a more modular approach, we have lots of different applications doing different things, they can't all access the sound card at once. So you go for a sound server. Now, there are a couple of different desktop sound servers. There's ESD, the Enlightenment sound server, and KDE is one which is for art. But Jack is somewhat different. It's designed specifically for real-time operation. The difference being that if you're running like a serious set of music applications, you know, like a half a second latency will be a big deal. You know, you don't want like one app to be out of time than the other. If you're just running like desktop sounds and you know, like Flash plugin or something like that, it's no big deal. So Jack is sort of purpose built for hard or close to hard real time work. So if I just click on start button, this is not actually the Jack server, this is like a control application for it, which we call Jack Control. It's a official title, it's QJack Control. I don't know if you can pronounce that. So. Well, some people call it QJack Control. Anyway, so I've just pressed start, and it's showing me up here that we're in real time mode, so that's good. And this is showing me my sample rate. This is like compact disc sample rate, 44.1 kHz. And this is my DSP load up here, so system's not exactly taxed here. Down here, in my connections window, this is my outputs. So I've got playback 1 and playback 2 on this, which are corresponding to left and right in this case. If I had a multi-channel interface, I might have 8 outputs there. If I was running a full duplex mode, I would also have 8 inputs running over the reader grid. So, let's start with the first Jack application. There's the Jack audio mastering interface. It's starting slowly for some reason today, but it will get there. This is a dedicated application for processing audio in real time. Mastering, called in the sort of audio world, in the TV film world it's called post-production, but it amounts to the same thing. What you're doing is you're taking in an audio signal and you're tweaking it up to make it sound better, to make it louder usually, to make it clearer. So that it will work on a variety of different sound systems, from a giant club sound system to tiny speakers. So, in the sort of proprietary domain, there are various sort of plugins that do this kind of job. But what Jamly does is it collects all those plugins together and puts them into a single GUI. So you've got one window. I'll demonstrate how you actually use it with running Arno. So I'm going to open a session I made already, and because it's got a rather shambolic and punk version of the world, it's got me very quite. So if I go back to my Jack Connections window, right, I've now got all my different Arda tracks, and we've got separate outputs. You can see all these lines here, all basically. Some of them are going out to, this is where it gets complicated, Arda's master bus, and then from there, I can't find it.
It's down below.
Is it? Oh, there it is, yeah. There we go. That is actually connected to... Oh, no, it's connected to Jamly, isn't it? Yeah, okay. It is getting complicated, I was right. We've got all the different tracks in Arda. They're playing into Arda's master bus. That is going into Jamin, and then we're routing the output of Jamin back to the sound card. So, and what that enables us to do is master our track in real time. There we go. We've got... It's not connected to Jamin. Interesting.
Yeah. Arda's not connected to Jamin.
Yeah. It was earlier. Never do it right. I'm sure I had that down. Okay. So.
Jam's not connected to us, so.
What is it? Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah, because it goes blue. Oh, so you can't see that on the projector. these lines here and there. So it's getting horrendously complicated, but it should work. So.
I should save those session templates.
You're right. I should have done that.
So you don't have to do that every time.
Yeah, you know that?
You can save the configuration.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. So Windows, show the mixer. Move that over to workspace. Yes, there is.
It's a hatchway, isn't it?
Yeah, under hatchway. You can set up root and save them and recall quite a few things. I should have done that, shouldn't I?
Can't remember. Yeah.
So, if I set this up right, we should be able to play the song. Mm-hmm. Band is so poor they have to make up their own records. Right, so. So this is the timeline. It's the little transfer. We've got a drum kit, over, left, right, bottom snare, top snare. I'm responsible for it. That was really the wrong time to press the solo button. Okay, so I've got another guitar going away over there. That stopped as well, hasn't it? Yeah, okay. Oh yeah, there we go, bass drum. We've got all our different tracks here. What I've done here is I've added a little bit of processing, because each of these tracks has an insert point. So if I take this one for example, that's on the kick drum, I've added a little equalization, put 12 dB gain, which is too much, but just for example purposes, at 90 Hz, which is the sort of pumping sort of low end of the bass drum. If I take that solo off, right now if I bypass that, you shouldn't hear a difference. That's without that EQ. Now, when a studio is mixing a track like this, they'll do all kinds of tricks with EQ and compression and limiting and so on to actually make the instruments stand out better. Because well, these days, if you're making music with like a live band, you can't achieve the same volume and clarity as synth-based bands. You know, they're all using samples and generated sounds. So yeah, mixing is all about sort of tweaking up stuff to make it louder, harder, you know, more clear, more audible. So that's the kind of trick that we would use. Of course, we have the track here, haven't we? Yeah. I'm going to go back through the track here. There's a transport button. So loud in his headphones that you can actually hear it on the guitar speaker. So David does like it up loud. So if I go back to a quiet bit, a relatively quiet bit. Right, get my bypass that gate, you will hear all the noise. That's what Dave's got in his headphones. You're going to hear on the mic, which is down here on the guitar, the Marshall stand. Ear frying loud headphones. So I've gated that out. And there's loads of Latper effects, there's more than 100. So you've got EQs, limiters, compressors, reverbs, and you know, all the sort of usual effects that you use in this kind of first setting. If I do an example, for some reason we're getting more shown twice, but we've got bypass filters, there's another bug to fix, and delays, lots of unknowns, amplifiers, oscillators, converters, phasers. In fact, if I run through them by type, we get distortions. Each one of these is a different level. So, you're able to have time for all of those, but it's done well. Now, if we go to the last one, this is showing the like frequency spectrum for this particular track. I'll have to unmute that. Yeah.
possibilities.
Any questions at that point? Cool. No questions? Okay.
I just wanted to ask what the CPU use was like during that.
Okay. Well, the DSP figure is this is jack reports. That's up here. See, obviously it's not doing anything at the moment.
Yeah.
If I mean, jamming is particularly CPU hungry by sort of new Linux standards, because it's doing quite a hard job. It's doing a lot of real time maths.
Right.
Okay, that's probably that's not true. I think there's a
getting from jack.
Yeah, I think that would be the same figure. Yeah, so that's not right. It's definitely not 1.9%. It was more like yesterday I was getting like 50%. So I don't know what number. I'm just doing the EP processing as well. This is all it is. It's not violent, but it's not straining. And that's a Turium, I think it's like 1.4 GHz. It's bottom of the range, basically, a Turium ND64 laptop processor. So, I mean, I have a dual Opteron in my office, and that barely breaks 30% in this kind of work. And even including jamming, which is particularly CPU hungry. And I think the one in my studio is just a single Opteron. That's, I rarely see anything above 50%. So it can handle it.
How do you manage a sound generated by a dual Opteron?
By what, sorry?
How do you manage the sound generated by the dual Opteron machine?
Oh, the noise! Yeah, the noise from the fans. Oh yeah, that is a problem. That's why I only have a single Opteron in the studio. The dual Opteron in the office, because the extra processor does make more noise, definitely, with the extra fan. What I've done is I've actually modified the... I've got them in server cases, and I've modified them to make less noise, using speed-reduced fans and special power supply and that kind of thing. But yeah, a dual Opteron, you wouldn't want to have it like actually on your desk, I don't think, for this sort of work, because you'll never hear silence again. Yeah, ringing. If you actually get like a dual Opteron server out of the box and stick it on your desk, it sounds like two demented vacuum cleaners running amok. So I mean, even with the modifications, it's still relatively noisy. I think the best hope for low noise sort of machines is, AMD are doing a 35-watt version of the Athlon 64X2, which is a dual-core AMD 64 processor. I built a machine with one of those, and that was pretty quiet, because there used to be like single-core Pentium 4s that use double that, thermal energy. So with a special noise damping case, it's doable. So, any more questions?
Well, what kind of audio devices do you have?
This one?
Yeah.
This is an M Audio mobile pre, and it's actually two microphone preamps in here, and it's running the ASA driver with the generic USB audio driver. Because the good thing about these kind of devices is that when they first came out, they all had proprietary vendor written drivers. And the vendors themselves discovered that was a major pain, so they actually started to make their devices more class compliant. And so you've got things like this today, which, well, that's about like a year old or something. just plug it into a Linux box and bing, it's there. And, because they've actually found that, you know, standards work. it's much less work for them if they use the standards. But this actual device, when it very first came out, which was about like 3 years ago or something, it had like a blue panel on the front, sort of a grey one. And that one, you have to upload proprietary firmware to it to make it work. And there's no good reason for that, other than that the manufacturers didn't follow the generic USB audio spec for whatever reason. And now they've come around to the right way of thinking. So. That's good. I mean, this is a relatively low-cost device. It's about £90, I think, something like that. It's just basically a low-cost upgrade for a laptop audio, so you can use proper microphones with XLR and Phantom power. So yeah, it's pretty good for what it does, but it's not as good as some of the sort of professional interfaces they have now, which have maybe 8 microphone inputs and an extra 16 channels of ADAPT. And they're usually firewire out. So we're actually fortunate enough to have a really good generic firewire audio support in GNU Linux now through the what was called the FreeBob project. It's now called FADO with 2 F's. I think that's the right pronunciation. But that supports not only the original firewire interfaces, which were based on a firmware called BBob, it's FreeBob. It also supports the newer DICE 2 based firmware devices. So, and what you can actually now do is take a Debian, whatever you've got, sort of a box with FireWire port, stick in one of these interfaces, and you can get it working out of the box. And the great thing about FADO, which is the revision of FreeBob, is that because it supports not only these original group of classical wired devices, but also these new ones that are coming on stream as well, is you can take two different firewire audio interfaces from two completely different manufacturers running two completely different chipsets and plug them in sort of daisy chain through firewire and actually have the whole lot work as one big virtual interface. Now, like on the proprietary platforms, the drivers can't do that because they're all vendor written and they're all different, right? So, but we actually have better support now than any other platform because of this this FADO driver. And it's we got the FreeBob driver in this version of 64 Studio, the first version. But the obviously FADO is a thing we're going to want to put in later. The current state of FireWire audio with this particular version of the distro is that if you have a BBob based interface like Presonus, make one called the Firebox, and one smaller called the FirePod. M-Audio makes several. You just plug it in, and instead of selecting ALSA in jack control, in the setup window, here's we've got interface here, which is the mobile preamp. This is the onboard sound card of the laptop. Instead of selecting ALSA, you just select FreeBob. And you get FireWire interface working just as we have with this one. And that covers, like as I say, any of those original BBob interfaces. Because a lot of the manufacturers, although they have different brand names on their products, actually all buy chipsets from the same small group of vendors, you know, just like their Ethernet cards. So that's great because most of the products on the market now are now supported by free software. I mean, there are a couple of holdouts. We still, have our own proprietary firmwares and so on. But there is some reverse engineering going on. So even those can be supported relatively. Any more questions? Okay. I think I've used up all my time. If there's anything anyone wants to see specifically, just come up and ask me. It's going to be here for a while. I'll be here tomorrow as well, Monday morning, if anyone wants to try. There's also the machine at the back there, that's running the 64 Studio 1.0, with a stable release from last autumn, if you want to have a try on that. Does anybody want to take a look over there now? I can show you a couple of things on that.
How did you release 64 Studio from here?
Well, this release, which is 1.40, is the current release from the website, it's Edge. plus our sort of recipe for packages. What we have is instead of like hand selecting packages all the time, we have like a recipe which says, okay, we want this synth, that synth, we want Ardo, we want Jack and Jamal and these kind of things. And it pulls down those packages from an Etch repository and auto-builds an ISO image. You could replicate exactly the same thing yourself by starting with an Etch install and then adding all the packages and then adding a real-time patch kernel and then adding all the little tweaks that we've made, the scripts and so on. But that would just take you like a couple of days, and you can save yourself the effort by just getting the installer ISO from our website, installing that. It certainly takes about half an hour because a lot of the questions are pre-seeded. It speeds things up a lot. Then add Debian packages from there. So because this one is in sync with Etch, you just show you the package management.
So you can just upgrade to Debian from this?
Well, you could do, but you shouldn't need to, strictly speaking, because we're keeping our distro up to date with Debian as well.
What's the difference? So the kernel is very different.
It's not super different. What it is Ingo Molnar at Red Hat has been working for some time on real-time patches for the 2.6 kernel, and we use those because to run Jack in real-time mode, you have to have those. So this is obviously Synaptic. Setting repositories. So what have I got? So on this particular laptop, I've still got entries left over from the install CD I actually used on this machine, which was 1.3. As it goes over there. This is our stable app source, which we would use for like 1.0 upgrades and so on. And we also have this one, which I'm running on this laptop, is our testing branch. This is not Debian testing, this is our own testing branch, which is based on Etch plus backported packages. So for example, we find a bug that's in Etch itself, and we have a backport server, and we build packages against Etch from SID. So it's the version that's in SID, but built for Etch. And that keeps everything nicely synced up. And then if you want to, you don't have to, but we actually put these are our, pretty much our default package list that you get when you install the distro for the first time. You can just enable Etch and then get all the packages from Etch. I mean, I think there's just under 1,000 packages at the moment in the 64 Studio base install. So that keeps it down to a sort of a manageable number that we can actually track and update. We try not to duplicate too much. Like, for example, when we were looking for an instrument tuner application, there were about like 5 different ones to choose from. So we went through all of them, and we found the one that we thought was the best, and we made that the default. If you want one of those other 4, whatever they are, that are Debian, then you just name your Etch source and go and get it. What we found is that sometimes, you go through that approach, and sometimes the best of breed package isn't actually in Debian, in which case we make a Debian package and we upload it to SID, and then eventually it propagates back down. So, also, of course, now we're based on Etch, you can use the security updates. This is something we wanted to have for a long time because although we've got a pretty good security record, nobody's ever complained of a major, security hole or anything like that over the last 2 years. We want to keep people, especially non-technical users, updated with things like ISOWeasel updates and things like that. So. Because the people who are like least aware of security are the people who need it the most, probably. So we use Update Manager now, and you can set that to remind you, that there's a new Firefox or ISOWeasel package or whatever it is that you have. So yeah, that's pretty much the same as Debian. We're using Secure Apt now in this release. A lot of these packages are straight from Debian, so For example, this one is specific to people who have that Intel chipset and it doesn't work properly without it. So that's just like as is from dead end. And then we've also got these packages here, which are some dummy custom packages. This is our app data, this is scale stuff, task cell. You know, and this is where a lot of the little tweaks are in the utilities package as well, that we've made just to set things up the right way. It could be as simple as like enabling a menu entry or not enabling it, or making a window in the right place or not. And then, yeah, a lot of these other packages are straight from Debian. There are a couple of exceptions. I think the, go up to Alice. Yeah, we do ship ASA firmware, which Debian doesn't ship, because if you've got an RME sound card or some of the others, it actually needs that firmware upload to work with the free driver, otherwise it just won't work. You know, ASA will get started and nothing. So we took the decision to actually ship the firmware because we, although there's a theoretical argument over whether it's, you know, it's free enough or not free or whatever, we thought that if we have a system that's like 100% pure free software, but like our target users can't actually use it, then that's not actually a step forward. So we came down on that side of the firmware debate in the end. You know, I mean, I suppose it's a pragmatic view. We prefer the system to be like 99.5% free software than 0% free software. Yeah, I think it is in non-free, but you won't get it in WMA.
Yeah,
of course. So, yeah.
Cool.
I mean, there are distributions like GNU Sense, which, you know, like, no firmware whatsoever, and we don't think that's feasible for our target users, because if you've got like an RME interface, you've got a serious studio machine, and you pop in a 64 studio disk or a Debian disk, and it just doesn't work. You know, you've heard that, you know, GNU Linux and ALSA support your hardware, and yet it just doesn't work. You know, you're not going to probably use it again, are you? So, that's the approach we're taking. So we've got lots of different helpful things like spell checking dictionaries and things like that. Things we never thought we'd actually need, but you go into an application and you click like spell check, and this is like dictionary not found. You know, so these are things that we've filled in over the years. So yeah, there's just under 1,000 packages in a standard install. We've only recently gone over a 700 megabyte install limit, which is why we switched to DVD. It's about 750 meg at the moment, and we try to pack everything we can into that. We actually found though that although some people said, "Oh, well, I don't have a DVD writer and I can't make install DVDs," we actually found that a DVD would write and install significantly faster than a CD-ROM for the same amount of data because of the higher transfer rates of the DVD drive. So, you know, it's a choice of like obsoleting the very, very old hardware or having, you know, faster installs. We went for faster installs. So, although we do, we took the decision sort of fairly early on that although we'd originally intended just to support the very newest hardware like AMD 64 CPUs and later the Intel 64 ones, pretty soon people said, well, actually, I don't have an AMD 64 machine, but I'd really like to use this. And some people said, well, I've got like a college where we have like 10 AMD 64 machines and we have like 50 32-bit Pentium 4, and we want to have the same environment running on both, so that when we come to upgrade the hardware later, we can just have a smooth transition. So that's when we started doing two ISOs, AMD 64 and i386 ISO, which works on pretty much all 32-bit systems. That's running the background there, is running the 32-bit version because it's Pentium 4. So, any more questions? Let's see if there's...